Yeah, hello and welcome. Today we will define what is a real closure of an ordered field. We will prove that such a real closure always exists, and we will prove using our methods for root counting, namely today we will use Hermite's method. We will prove that the real closure is essentially unique. Okay, so let's go to subsection 1.7 about real closure. So here we are. So you know from algebra that if you have a field K, but there always exists a field extension, an extension field C, such that C over K is algebraic. So meaning that every element from C is the root of a polynomial with coefficients from K, of a non-zero polynomial with coefficients from K, right? And such that C is algebraically closed, meaning that every polynomial, every non-constant polynomial with coefficients from C has a root in C. So such a field, such an extension field is called an algebraic closure of a field K. And we know that it is unique in the following sense. So whenever we have another algebraic closure, C prime, then there is a field isomorphism from C to C prime. Let's say phi. Such that phi restricted to K is the identity on K. Yes, so today we will develop the corresponding real notion. So in the real world, we deal with orders. So we have here an ordered field, right? So let's see. So KP, an ordered field. And then if you have an algebraic extension R, algebraic over K, which is real closed, you already know what real closed means, right? Which is real closed. So this must be, by the way, this R should be as a field an algebraic extension field of K, but as an ordered field it should be also an extension as an ordered field of KP, right? So that's why I write here the unique order on R. So now I think it should be clear that I mean an ordered field extension here. But R should be algebraic over K. And now, if I have here a second real closed field, let me call it R prime, together with its unique order, real closed, which is also a real closure, by the way, a real closed field is a real closure of an ordered field, of course, if it's an algebraic extension as a field and it's an extension as an ordered field. And it is real closed, right? So, okay, so if I have a second real closed field, we will prove that there is an isomorphism here between R and R prime, which is the identity on K. But moreover, we will prove something which we couldn't prove in the classical case. We will even prove that this is that there is a unique isomorphism, which is the identity on K. Yeah, and so this will be very analogous to the theory of the algebraic closure. And for the unicity, for the existence of this isomorphism phi, we will have to use the real root counting. We will use Hermite's method, which we developed last time for real root counting. Okay? So now let's start the real closure. Let Kp be an ordered field. An extension field R of K is called a real closure of Kp. If R is real closed, R over K is algebraic, and the order of R, there is a unique order of A, right, of R, because R is a Euclidean. In a Euclidean field, the squares form the only order. Maybe I should actually refer to 1, 4, 5, where this was explicitly mentioned. And 1, 4, 3 was just the fact that we often understand a Euclidean field, and in particular a real closed field, as an ordered field without saying it, right? If there is an extension of P, so it must be an ordered field, an extension as ordered fields is an extension of P. And by 1-3-1, there were several characterizations of what this means. For example, this just means that P is contained in the unique order of R, which is given by the squares in R, right? So you could just say P, the condition that the order of R is an extension of P just means that P is contained in R squared, if you want. Now, probably you still know from algebra the following characterization of algebraically closed fields, namely a field C is algebraically closed if and only if it has no proper algebraic extension. So, meaning that there is no field L such that L over C is algebraic, but L is different from C. Right? Ah, there is no, sorry, yes. Okay, so here we have the corresponding characterization for real closed fields. Let R, so we start again with an ordered field. Let RP be an ordered field. I call it now R because I'm speaking, but I want to characterize when it is real closed. I could also write KP, of course. I can use any letter. When R is real closed, if and only if there is no ordered field extension field LQ of RP, such that L is different from R and L over R is algebraic, right? So you do exactly the same thing, but now with ordered fields. Exactly the same characterization, but now with ordered fields. Okay, one direction follows from 1-4-13C, which was the following, namely, if R is a field, then it's equivalent to say that R is real closed and that R is real, but there is no real extension field. L different from R such that L over R is algebraic, right? So that was a bit similar because, that R is real means that there exists an order, right, on R. And this means, but when there is no proper algebraic extension for which there exists also an order, right? So this is a bit similar, but it's different, right? Because the order, this algebraic, the order on the algebraic extension field. Must respect only one order on R, right? Of course, it must. Okay, if the extension field is real, when there exists an order on L, right? This order, I can restrict it to R, of course, right? So in some sense, there must be an order on L which extends an order on R, right? But the difference is here that here I can fix the order on R, I can fix the order P, and I look only at those extensions that extend really this given order P. That's really a different thing, right? But one direction follows now, of course, from this. Let's see which one. So, if R is real closed, right? When C is true, and when when I cannot find this LQ, right? Because LQ would be a proper real extension, algebraic extension of R, right? So with the other direction now, conversely, suppose that every ordered extension field LQ of RP with L over R algebraic satisfies L equal R. And when we have to show that that R is real closed, so we have to show R is Euclidean, and that means the squares form an order. And second, every polynomial of odd degree has a root, right? Okay, for A, we show that that this order P, which was given on R, is R squared, right? It's clear, I mean, that's what we have to show. I mean, if it's right that R is Euclidean, then the squares form not only an order, but they form a unique order, and then it must be equal to P. So the only candidate, so the only candidate for P would be the squares then, right? So let's just show that P is the squares, that P is the set of all squares in R. So one direction is of course clear, every order contains every square, but for the other direction, let A be in P. Now we have to show that A is a square. Now we can first extend, A is certainly a square in some field extension, right? Because we cannot join the square root of A. We had our extension theorems for orders. And here is the one we will use now. That's the one for quadratic field extensions. So the order P can be extended to K adjoint square root of D, if and only if D is in P, okay? And since A was in P, we can extend this order to R adjoint square root of A, to this extension field. And due to the hypothesis, this implies that, of course, this is an algebraic extension also, so it must be R. In fact, it was not a proper extension. But when the square root of A lies in R, and A is its square, and therefore is a square in R. Okay. So, now we still have to show part B here, that every polynomial of odd degree has a root. So let f be such a polynomial of odd degree. Now we want to use again extension theorems, right? So we would need a field extension. And the theorem we want to use is actually this one. If L, because we have here odd degree, so maybe we need to use the theorem for field extensions of odd degree. So if L of k is a field extension of odd degree, then each order can be extended to L. Okay, so now maybe the idea is, okay, let's take a root of f in some algebraic extension of R. And if this extension were of odd degree, then then we could show that this root actually lies already in R. But how to make sure that this extension is also of odd degree? So there might be a problem if f is not irreducible, right? So if f is not irreducible. So, but if f has odd degree, then maybe not every prime factor of f has odd degree, but there must be at least one irreducible divisor with odd degree, right? Okay. So let's take such a divisor, choose an irreducible divisor g of f of odd degree, and choose a root x of g in some extension field of R. That's certainly possible, for example, in the algebraic closure or in the splitting field of g over R. That's algebra, right? When and this when R adjoint X is an extension field of R of finite degree over R, meaning that over as an R vector space it has finite dimension and actually odd dimension, namely the degree of this irreducible divisor, right? So that P can be extended now to R adjoint X by the theorem, by this extension theorem, which we had seen. Okay, by hypothesis, now we have that cannot be a proper extension because otherwise you would have a proper algebraic extension of ordered fields. So R adjoint X must be R. So in particular, G has a root in R, namely X, and therefore also F, because G is a divides F, right? Okay. Now, theorem 173, every ordered field has a real closure. That's already the existence theorem. Okay, so let's go. So why does every ordered field admit a real closure? So you might remember the proof that every field has an algebraic closure. That was a bit technical, if you remember. And now you might also remember that if I have an algebraic field extension of a field K, so L is algebraic over K, and if I have algebraically closed field K, C, extending K, so algebraically closed. And you might remember that you can embed actually L into C, so there exists an homomorphism, a field homomorphism, from L to C, which is of course injective, right? Because field homomorphisms are always injective, and which is the identity on K, right? So in some sense, so when that means that L is over K isomorphic to a subfield of C, right? So in some sense, up to renaming of new elements, which are not already in K, any algebraically closed extension field of K contains every algebraic extension of K, right? In particular, if C is the algebraic closure of K, from which we know it exists, when every algebraic extension of K is in some sense contained there, right? So, and a real closure, of course, is also an algebraic extension, right? So in order to show the existence of a real closure, we will certainly be able to use the existence of an algebraic closure in some way. And in fact, it is really like that. So let KP be an ordered field. And the first thing we do is, in fact, we consider the algebraic closure K bar of K, right? I say the algebraic closure because also it's unique up to isomorphism over K, right? Good. Now, inside this algebraic closure, we look at we look at intermediate fields, right? So we have here now the algebraic closure, and here we have K, but K carries this order P, right? And now we look here at intermediate fields L that are so the thing is that in the end we need that if you are looking for a real closure, we need that P is contained in the unique order of L, right? So the idea in order how to ensure this in the end is that we actually look at ordered field extensions LQ of KP, right? L an intermediate field of the algebraic of the field extension algebraic closure of K over K. Good. So I look at all these intermediate fields ordered. I mean, the algebraic closure, there is no order here, but at ordered field extensions LQ, so KP is an ordered subfield of LQ, Q is an order of L, and L should be a subfield of K bar. Yeah, I look at these things. And this set is a partially ordered set by declaring that LQ is less than or equal. I use this curly less than or equal sign here for partial orders often. So LQ is less than or equal L prime Q prime by definition if LQ is an ordered subfield of L prime Q prime. Good. And which means by 1120b, actually the b should be in the normal font, not in italic. So let's correct this in the script. Okay, so by 1120b, this means that's just that just means that because everything was anyway a subfield of K bar, this means just that L is contained in L prime and Q is actually contained in Q prime, right? Okay, and that's, so here you see it's of course a partial order, reflexive, transitive, antisymmetric. So in this partially ordered set, every chain, every linearly ordered subset possesses an upper bound. And you always have to consider the empty chain. For the empty chain, one has often to look at it separately. So in this case, the empty chain, I mean, every element of a partially ordered set is an upper bound of the empty chain. So I need just to verify that there is an element in my partially ordered set. But yeah, KP is, of course, an element of my partially ordered set, right? So now interesting are non-empty chains. So if I have a non-empty chain, then I take, of course, what else should I take? I take the union of these subfields, and actually in some sense I take the union as an ordered subfield. That means I also take the union of the orders, right? And so the union of the first components and the union of the second components. I take the union component-wise in some sense, right? I take component-wise the union. And then the union of the first components, because this was a chain of fields, is again a field, right? That's always the same argument. I won't do it now. You have seen it many times. And in the same way, you show that the union of these orders is an order. Of course, since it was a non-empty chain, it will again be true that P is contained in this union, right? And that K is contained here, of course, in this union. And what do we need? Now this shows that this lies in M, right? So, and it's of course an upper bound, yeah, it's constructed in this way. It's an upper bound for this chain. Okay, so let us see. By Thorne's lemma, if I have a partially ordered set in which every chain possesses an upper bound, this partially ordered set possesses at least one maximal element. So M possesses a maximal element, at least one, RQ. Of course, K bar is also the algebraic closure of R. And yes, of course, it's even algebraic over K, so it's also algebraic over R. And it's algebraically closed, of course, and therefore each algebraic extension of R is an intermediate field of K bar over R up to isomorphy over R. That's what I have mentioned, right? But because you can always embed these algebraic extensions, the maximality of RQ in M signifies by 172 just that R is real closed, right? So, right, because if there were a proper ordered extension field which is algebraic over R, I could think of it as a subfield of my algebraic closure K bar. So the maximality of RQ in M means by 172 that R is real closed. Because of RQ in M, the field extension R over K is algebraic, and Q is an extension of P. Now that's very really crucial. We need this Q extends P. I think that was the main reason why we didn't work with why we needed really this proposition 172, where we characterize the real closeness really with ordered field extensions, right? Okay. Good. So we have that where every ordered field has a real closure. Now we want to find out if it's unique in some way. And for this we need a little lemma. That's the only thing we will need from the real root counting. So let's note what we really need from the real root counting from the last lecture. Let KP be an ordered subfield of real closed fields R and R prime, right? Real closed field can always be seen as an ordered field, since it has a unique order, and when we often see it as an ordered field, that was 1, 4, 3. Okay, so when F has the same number of roots in both R and R prime, if F is a polynomial over K, right? So, yeah, so why is this? Without loss of generality, F is monic, right? So meaning that the coefficient belonging to the highest monomial of a monomial of highest degree is 1. The number in question is, namely the number of roots, is by 166 equal to the signature of H of F, of a Hermite form of F, right? It can be calculated already in KP, right? So it's a bit subtle. Actually, I have also to correct here a little, because we will need not only 161H, but also 161F. And, calculated in KP, maybe one should perhaps rather say over AP, so I calculate with quadratic forms whose coefficients are in KP. So what do I mean by that? Okay, so for this we need to look at all these things we did last time in the context of Hermite's root real root counting. So here is everything we need. So we had this method, by rewriting quadratic forms over fields of characteristic different than 2 in this way, so that you express them as a linear combination of squares of linearly independent linear forms, right? So we can do this in the field K. So, so why do we look at quadratic forms? Because the Hermite form, right? So remember this counting roots in real closed fields, right? So we want to count the roots over R, in R and in R prime. So we have given this polynomial F in the common subfield of R and R prime. R and R prime are real closed, and we want to count the roots in R and in R prime. And now what I say is that the count yields the same number in both ways, because it goes exactly the same. Why does it go exactly the same? Because we have to look at the Hermite form of F. But if you remember what is the Hermite form, right, you took the companion matrix, you took powers of a companion matrix of F. So if F, in reality, if your polynomial F has all coefficients in a subfield K of R, then the companion matrix will be a matrix over K, the powers will be matrices over K, the traces of these powers will be over K. So the Hermite form actually is a quadratic form over K, right? It's actually a quadratic form over K. And now, in order to compute its signature, its Sylvester signature, right, which is the number of roots in the real closed field, how do you compute the signature? Well, that's here written, unfortunately, only for Euclidean field. It is written here, right? But let's first look at this thing. Anyway, we can write the Hermite form, which is a quadratic form, in this way, right? With linearly independent linear forms, and we have some lambda k here, right? And now we can of course suppose that these lambda k are all non-zero, okay? And now these lambda k's are either positive or negative in my ordered field Kp, right? Some of them are positive in my ordered field Kp and some are negative. And I can do that in k, right? And now I look at the Sylvester signature of my quadratic form. If I could show that was Sylvester signature of my quadratic form with coefficients from k, is the same with respect to r as to r prime, when the number of roots is the same in r and r prime, right? Yes, so how do you compute the Sylvester signature? Well, you have to take a representation like this, but you still have to do one thing. You have to write these lambda k's as squares, which you can do in a real closed field. And you have to put them, you have to hide them in the linear form somehow, right? So you write lambda k as a square or as minus a square. And then this square you can somehow hide in the linear form. And when you can write it in R, you can write it like this. And in R prime, you can also write it like this. But the number of lambda k's which you write as a square and those which you write as minus a square will be the same in R and in R prime, right? Because the positive elements will get a square, no matter whether in R and R or in R prime, and the elements from K which are minus a square, which are negative in K, in Kp, will get minus a square, no matter if you look at this in R or in R prime. So you get always the same Sylvester signature, right? No matter if you do with respect, if you see the polynomial as a polynomial over R or over R prime, the Hermite form will have the same Sylvester signature, right? So in some sense, you have an algorithm to compute the Sylvester signature over your field K, right? Over the field K, you might not have such a representation, but very similar. You have here some positive lambda i's, positive, and here you have some mu j's, negative, right? And positive and negative with respect to the order p on K. And so you can compute this by computing just in K, right? So it's a bit like, you know, if a system of linear equations over rational numbers, for example, if it has a solution over complex numbers, then it will also have a solution over the real numbers. Why? Because you just do Gaussian elimination and you can do this over the rational numbers, right? And after you have done the Gaussian elimination, you just see if it has a solution or not. And that does not depend on the extension field which you look at. And here it's a bit the same. You compute everything over Kp and you just see if the Sylvester signature, and by Hermite's real root counting, you see the number of roots counted without multiplicity, right? Good. Now I remind you again of a theorem from algebra, which I've already talked about today. So if L over K is an algebraic field extension, and if I have here a homomorphism from K into an algebraically closed field, when I can extend this homomorphism to L in some sense, meaning that there is a homomorphism here which makes this diagram commute, right? So which extends a given homomorphism from K to C to L, right? This will in general not be unique. For example, if you have here reals and here you have a complex numbers and here you have a complex numbers and everything is just your identity here. Everything is just your identity. When there will be two such extensions here, right? Because you have a complex conjugation, right? So there is no uniqueness. Here we prove now we an analogous theorem in the real case. So let Kp be an ordered subfield. So here we work with ordered fields, of course, right? So let Kp be an ordered subfield of LQ, right? And let R be real closed, R real closed. And let phi be an homomorphism of ordered fields, right? So that means that phi of P is contained in the unique order of R in the squares. And when there is exactly one homomorphism psi of ordered fields, from LQ to R, which extends phi, right? So it's exactly the same theorem, but I'm working with ordered fields, and therefore I'm working with homomorphism of ordered fields. And, but there is one thing is different, we have is exactly one. We have that's even better, right? We have, we have exactly one here, right? So now let's go to the proof. So first of all, I choose a real closure R prime of LQ. Okay, so let me again draw the whole situation. So here I have Kp. Here I have an homomorphism of ordered fields into a real closed field R. Here I have the algebraic ordered field extension LQ. And now I have, I choose here with real closed, with real closure R prime. So according to 173, every ordered field possesses a real closure. So that means an algebraic extension, which is real closed. Extension as an ordered field, of course, even, right? Yeah. Now, for the existence part, so I want to show, there is here a unique homomorphism of ordered fields, psi. Now, the unicity I will show later, I will now show the existence, right? Why does there such a psi exist that restricts to the given homomorphism phi? Right. Okay, so yeah, using Zorn's lemma, I mean actually a little bit more than that. Using Zorn's lemma, one reduces easily to the case where L over K is finite. So why is this? Well, I can look at intermediate fields between L and K, right? Actually, intermediate ordered fields. So that would be fields of a form, let me see, so L prime, oh no, KLM, PQR, so ordered fields MR somewhere here between, so intermediate fields of a field extension L over K, such that P contained in R, R contained in Q, right? And together with homomorphisms, field homomorphisms extending phi to R, right? Let me call a row such a field homomorphism here. So I have triples M R row, right? And I can define a partial order on these, right? So another such triple. And of course, it's clear like you do this, right? If M is contained in M prime and R is contained in R prime and rho prime restricted to R is rho, right? Then this defines a partial order. And then you show that every, in this partially ordered set, every chain has an upper bound. And of course, the empty chain, for the empty chain, you can take Kp together with phi. And then if you have a non-empty chain, you know, you take the union of the first components of underlying fields, the union of the orders in the second component, and the union of the graphs of these field homomorphisms in the third component, then you will see that this component-wise union, if you want, is an upper bound, of course, for such a chain. And it's always the same thing. It's just technical, just write up. If you have done it several times, then you know what I'm speaking about. Otherwise, just do it. And so using Sorn's lemma, we see that we get a maximal intermediate ordered field here to a maximal triple here, right? And now if I could show when either this is already LQ and some map psi, right? Either the first two components are already L and Q together, and the third component is some map psi, and when I have a psi, or it is not, so it's still properly contained, M such a maximal element triple M R rho is still properly contained in L, so M is still properly contained in L. Well, in this case, I can choose a finite field extension here over M R. I can choose here again an intermediate ordered field that is finite over M. And now if I can use the already proven case where the field extension over, if I've already proven my theorem for finite field extensions, so meaning that L over K is finite, now I can apply this to a new situation instead of L and K, I apply it to this finite extension of M and M, right? And then I could and then I would get the contradiction to the maximality of MR, right? So in this way we can reduce to a finite to a situation where L over K is finite, right? It's just one line here, but it's a lot of work, but for experienced people, one line is sufficient and you are now experienced. So we denote the different field homomorphisms from L to R. So now we have a finite here. Now we have here a finite. So let me say here we have here finite extension. L is a finite dimensional K vector space. Okay. So now there is another twist, which I forgot actually in the lecture notes. So I should do this now. I should correct this. So now I want, now I say without loss of generality, phi restricted to K is the identity on K. And hence, Kp, and hence R, or hence Kp is an ordered subfield of R. Kp is an ordered subfield of R. I mean, phi being a field homomorphism between fields, it's injective, so it's an embedding. And I mean, it's also an homomorphism of ordered fields, so it's an embedding of ordered fields. So the ordered field Kp is isomorphic to the ordered field phi of K. So Kp as an ordered field is isomorphic to the ordered field phi of K, phi of P, right? And that's clearly a subfield, if you want, of R, or an ordered subfield of R, right? If you let me write it in that way. clearly, for what I want to prove, I could just exchange R by an isomorphic field which really contains Kp instead of phi of K, phi of P, right? Technically, how would you do this? Okay, you have to be a bit careful. Main idea is that phi of A for A in K will be exchanged by A. When you have to be careful because A could be already in there somehow, so you would first have to to make a copy of A or something, or replace A by another new element. So technically, it's a purely set theoretical problem, right? How you would do this, right? So, but that brings us to a nicer picture in some sense. So, since R is now an ordered extension field, picture is now as follows. So R is now here, it's real closed. And I want here phi psi such that psi restricted to K is the identity. Right? Ah, and of course R is, okay, yes, good. So now we denote different field homomorphisms from L to R. Here I wrote extending phi, but now I want to write, now this means extending the identity, right? So yeah, I could let it like this, but I could also write different field homomorphisms. So what in algebra we used sometimes when the term K homomorphism, I don't know what I will finally write in the lecture notes, but different K homomorphisms, that's a field homomorphism fixing pointwise K from L to R by psi 1 up to psi m. So there are only finitely many. You should know this from algebra, right? If R were Als Sprekeli closed, when the number of his field homomorphisms would be the separability degree of L over K, which is finite, right? If you know what that is, if not, that's no problem. But there are only finitely many. Yeah, you can prove that in several ways. One way of proving this, I assume that you know it anyway, but one way of proving it would, by the way, be to use a primitive element theorem. That means if you have a finite separable extension, separability here you have here in any case, because we are in characteristic zero. So if you have this finite separable field extension L over K, it's generated by one element. That means L arises from K by adjoining, in the field theoretic sense, just one element, right? Just one element from L, and every homomorphism from L to R must of course map this element to a root of its minimal polynomial in R. Yeah. Okay. So that would be one way of proving it. And actually with primitive element theorem, we will now use in a minute, but you could also use it for that purpose, for showing that there are only finitely many of such field homomorphisms. So I don't know how many, I don't claim that there is any. So M could be zero a priori, I don't claim at the moment yet that there is one. Now, what I have to show is that there is one, and that there is actually one respecting the order, mapping Q to the order here in R, so mapping Q to the squares in R. So assume that none of these, but I assume the contrary, assume that none of these is a homomorphism of ordered fields from LQ to R. For example, if there is no psi I, so if M is zero, right? Or if there are some psi I's, but they just don't map Q to the non-negative elements from R. So when there are B1 up to Bm in Q, such for M equals zero, that means nothing, right? Such that psi I of Bi is not a square in R, right? So these are the witnesses that Q is not mapped to the non-negative elements. By the primitive element theorem, which I have just quoted, there exists an A in L prime. So I adjoin to L with square roots, right? So I adjoin to L the square roots of the Bi's, right? And note that these square roots are elements of R prime, because the Bi's are squares in R prime, right? Now here it really pays off that I have chosen this real closure, because all these Bi's are in Q, right? And so they are squares in R prime, and so all these square roots lie in R prime, yeah. So this is a finite field extension of L. Maybe I should draw it in the picture. So here we have the L prime. It's also I could write it as an ordered field, so I can take R prime intersected L prime. Okay, so I have here, and this is a finite extension here. If I join finitely many algebraic elements, I get the finite extension, and that extension here is still algebraic. Okay. So I have this L prime, and now I use the primitive theorem, the primitive element theorem for the field extension L prime over L. So there exists an A in L prime, such that L prime is K adjoint A. Okay. Now the minimal polynomial of A over K has by 174 the same number of roots in R prime and R, because it's a polynomial with coefficients in K, right? Okay, so I use now 174 here. It's nothing to do with it's got nothing to do with the fact that a minimal polynomial is irreducible or something, just that it's a polynomial with coefficients in K. Okay, so it has the same number of roots in R prime and R, and therefore in particular it must have a root in R. Right, since A lies in L prime, so it has a root in L prime, therefore in R prime, so it must have root in R. So the only thing we actually use from 174 is that F has a root in R if and only if F has a root in R prime, right? Okay, one of the directions is enough, of course, but that, yeah. By exchanging R and R prime, I have both directions, right? Okay, so I could have formulated this lemma in a bit weaker and would still be enough for my application in this subsection here. But I need the real root counting. I don't know any other way of proving this if I don't think about how to count the roots. Okay. Now, I should also, so that I don't forget to change this in the script. Okay. Hence, there is a field. Hence, there is a field homomorphism psi from L prime to R extending phi. Now I'm not sure, did I actually say that A is a primitive element for the field extension L prime over L? Maybe I said this, right? That's now not really what I want. I want a little more, right? I want a little more. I should have chosen, and actually in the written lecture notes I did it, I should have chosen A as a primitive element for a finite field extension L prime over K, right? So, yeah, and that now explains why there is this homomorphism. Well, that's basic algebra, right? Because how is the situation? I have here KP, or I don't need the orders now for this thing. So I have here K, and if here K adjoint A, that's L prime, right? And now, but I have also a root, the minimal polynomial of A has a root B in R. So I have here K adjoint B, and this is contained in R, right? And A and B have the same minimal polynomial. The minimal polynomial of A over K is the minimal polynomial of B over K, right? And in this situation, go to your algebra course. You know that there is a field, a K isomorphism here, right? Between K adjoint A and K adjoint B. And it's easy to prove, right? Because both, both are isomorphic to polynomial ring in one variable modulo with minimal polynomial. Okay. So extending phi I wrote here, yeah, but now in the new version I should write there is a K homomorphism, that would be a good way of saying it, right? Okay. Good. Now choose I in 1 to M. So this must be 1. So you know, I could have done the same thing. I could have chosen a primitive element for L over K. And then with the same argument, I would see that that there is such a psi here, right? And that means that there is that M is bigger than zero. That M is bigger than zero, I could have seen it already just by taking a primitive element for L over K. But we want it more. We want it that it respects the order, right? That's why I took L prime. That's why I took here L prime, because now since this psi is defined on L prime, it maps these square roots here to something. It's defined on the square roots, and therefore it maps the bi to squares, right? And then I have a contradiction, right? So choose I in 1 to m such that psi restricted to L is psi I, right? Clearly, and now, as I said, I see also that m is bigger than zero. I could have seen it in a more easy way, but since I want more, I worked with L prime. So choose I such that psi intersected psi restricted to L is psi I. In particular, M is positive. When psi I of bi is psi of bi is psi of square root of bi squared is a square, right? Maybe put here some parentheses. And that's a contradiction, right? Because psi of bi should not be a square. Okay, that was quite a nice proof, I guess. And now we come to the unicity part, and I guess I can keep the same picture, actually. Maybe we don't need the L prime anymore here. Okay. So, aha. And maybe also we don't need... we will also use the R prime, I guess, yes. So, algebraic... And okay, maybe we don't need that. This is finite. It wouldn't matter too much, I guess. So this is almost the general situation, and now we want to prove that there exists only one such psi, right? But, okay, what I did again is that I assumed that Kp is an ordered subfield of R. Okay, but as I said, that's without loss of generality. And now I want to show that there exists at most one such psi here, right? At most one existence I have already, but I want to show that every two homomorphisms of ordered fields from LQ to R... are the same if they K homomorphisms, if they fix the fix K pointwise. Good. So unicity. So let A in L let A in L and I want to Now how do I do it? I somehow give I show that the image of A does not actually depend on the homomorphism psi of ordered fields that I'm looking at, right? So when I choose, so what are possible images of A? Well, I take a minimal polynomial, or I take actually any polynomial, any non-zero polynomial f, having A as a root, polynomial f over k. And I look at the roots of this polynomial in R, in R. I think it's a typo. It should be R, right? First I look at I look at R prime. Yes, I look at the roots of this polynomial here in R prime. Okay. So, and then, so I have here, maybe I should write it here. So I have here this root A. And then I look at all the roots in R prime of the same polynomial. So in R prime, it has finitely many roots, A1, up to am, and I can actually order them so that a1 is less than a2 and so on up to am. And then these have to be mapped. And the polynomial f has the same number of roots in R. Right, that's because of 174. So here I actually need the full strength of 174, contrary to what I said before, namely that my polynomial f has exactly the same number of roots in R. So there are b1, b2, and so on up to bm, the same number, and I can again order with these. So these are the roots of my polynomial in R. Now now A must be one of these AIs, right? So now comes here, now I write here that without loss of generality, Kp is an ordered subfield of R, which we have already clarified. We have done that already before now. It is better, so I don't need to do it now, so better don't forget to erase it in the script. I mark it here. So now I have these BIs, and these are the roots of F in R. And now A must be one of the AIs, right? We choose an I such that A equals AI, right? And now what I will do is I will show that every homomorphism psi here of ordered fields has to map the A to B I, and when I'm done, right? Because that's independent of psi. To this end, fix such a psi by the already proved existence statement. We can extend psi to a homomorphism of ordered fields from R prime to R. Such that rho is an extension, right? Here. Exactly. So with rho restricted to L is psi. Since row is an embedding, we have at VA eyes. So anyway, VA eyes have to be mapped to B eyes, but row is injective already. Is in, as a field homomorphism, row is injective. And it also respects the order because it's an homomorphism of ordered fields. So it must actually map A1 to B1, A2 to B2, and so on. So by the monotonicity, we even get that row of HJ, A1 must be mapped to B1, A2 to B2, and so on. And so we get row of HJ equals BJ for all J. We deduce that psi of A is psi of AI is row of AI is BI. And we are done. Okay, and that finishes the proof of this theorem, right? So, yes. Okay, so now consequences, corollary. 176, let R and R prime be real closures of the ordered field Kp when there is exactly one K isomorphism from R to R prime. So K isomorphism means a field isomorphism fixing pointwise the elements from K. So the K isomorphisms from R to R prime are obviously exactly the isomorphisms of ordered fields from R to R prime, whose restriction to K is the identity. What is here, the only thing that I want to say with this is that such a field isomorphism from R to R prime is automatically an isomorphism of ordered fields. But that's clear because the order in both cases in R and R prime are given by squares, right? Given by the squares, and a field isomorphism maps squares to squares, of course. Okay, for this reason, we claim follows easily from 175. From a preceding statement. So let's see why is this the case. So here we have Kp, here we have R, and here we have R prime. And both are real closed, and both are algebraic, and both are ordered field extensions. So why is there a K isomorphism? Because there is one, and it is there is a unique one. That's what is said. I use that R prime is real closed, right? And I use that this is an algebraic extension of ordered fields. So here, previous theorem says that there is a unique homomorphism of ordered fields here, which is the identity on K, right? Okay, and but this is only a homomorphism, is automatically injective, of course, but why is it surjective? So for the surjective, that's the only thing I think that you have to be careful, or have to argue a little bit for the surjectivity in the existence part. Use either 1.4.13c. or the unicity of K automorphisms of R and R prime. Let's first do the thing with the unicity. So that goes in the usual way. I could change the roles of R prime and R, and I see that there exists exactly one psi prime here, And when I look at, and what is here important is the existence here, not that it's unique. But when but when I can now look at RKP, right? And so here I have now on one hand I have psi. Let me see first psi prime composed with psi, right? Psi prime composed with psi, yes. And on the other hand, I have also the identity who does the same thing, and therefore, for because of the unicity, I have that this is the identity, and again, doing a similar argument now with R prime, I get here with so this is the identity on R, and then I get here a similar thing psi composed with psi prime is the identity of on R prime. And so I see that psi and psi prime are actually bijective, right? In this way I get the surjectivity of psi. Well, I could do it with this unicity of K automorphisms of R and of R prime. Yeah, and or I could do it with 1,4,13c. What is 1,4,13c? 1,4,13. Where is it? Yes, it's here. Yes. Using the real closeness, let's see, so there is no proper real algebraic field extension. So how do I get from this the surjectivity of psi? I guess that goes like follows. So in fact the idea is that the idea is that you look at an intermediate field here, namely psi of the image of psi of R, right? When this arrow here goes actually to this intermediate field here. But you know, the extension from R prime to K was algebraic, so I have here actually here an algebraic extension and here an algebraic extension, right? But since R is real, psi of R is of course also a real field, and now and actually a real closed, because R is real closed, this is also real closed, but when it doesn't admit a proper algebraic real extension, and R prime is an algebraic real extension, so when it follows that R prime is psi of R. So that's the idea behind of this argument. Okay, so maybe we should say what is different to the case of to a non-real theory. So corresponding classical theorem would be C, and let me write in color. So let C and C prime be algebraic closures of the field K, right? When there is exactly one K isomorphism from C to C prime. So that obviously wouldn't be right, right? So I think I said it already today. That wouldn't be right. Just take for k the reals, and take C and C, For C and C prime, I take the complex numbers. For K, I take the real numbers. And so it would mean that there is only one field isomorphism from the complex numbers to itself. So that means a field orthomorphism of the complex numbers, fixing the real numbers pointwise. But there are two, right? There is the identity and there is the complex conjugation. So what is really different? So it's exactly the same theorem in classical field theory, or in field theory without orders. It's the same theorem. I have some problems here. It's the same theorem, but what is here really better is that we have here exactly one, right? So that somehow not only R and R prime are as unique as you could ever expect, but they are in some sense uniquely unique, or there is a unique K isomorphism from R to R prime. Okay. Because there is this K isomorphism, we speak of the real closure of the ordered field Kp, and we introduce some notation, right? Just as we did for the algebraic closure. So we use a bar, but this time we put a bar over an ordered field because the order is really important. So just as in the classical case, every algebraic field extension of a field is up to isomorphism over a ground field contained in the algebraic closure. I have the same thing here, up to K isomorphy every ordered field extension LQ of KP with L over K algebraic is contained in the real closure as an ordered field, even, right? Everything with order, right? Everything with order. Okay. It contains up to K isomorphy every ordered field extension LQ of KP with L over K algebraic. Yes, well, this is by 175, right? That was here, right? Because such a homomorphism of ordered field is automatically injective and its image is as an ordered field isomorphic to, you know. Okay, so so now suppose that Kp is an ordered field, L over K is an algebraic extension, and so let's see, so Kp is an ordered field, L over K is an algebraic extension, and R is a real closed field. And phi homomorphism of ordered fields from Kp to R. And now I know that I can. Now the question is: so if L were an ordered field, LQ, an ordered extension field of Kp, when I knew that I can, you know, that I can extend phi to an homomorphism of ordered fields from LQ to R. But now I didn't specify an order on L. I want to say a different thing. I want to say that there is a bijection between the homomorphisms from L to R, psi, which restricted to K R, of course, phi again. And these orders Q on L that extend P, right? So yeah, you can think how this goes. So if I have such an order, I said it's induced, for every order to every order on L, I get such a psi, right? But if I have such a psi when I get an order on L, the thing is that everything is nice, so this is a bijection. So if I have such a homomorphism psi, then how do I get the order on L? I take a preimage of the order on R, right? That's clear. And this extends, of course, P, because phi, because psi extends phi, and phi was on phi mapped P to one of negative elements in R. And I claim that this is a bijection. Okay, so proof, well-definedness is easy to see. I think that was clear, right? To verify the bijectivity, let Q be an extension of P to L. We have to show that there is exactly one homomorphism psi from L to R with psi restricted to K is phi that fulfills the condition that the preimage of a non-negative elements in R are exactly Q. So we have to show that there is exactly one such homomorphism phi fulfilling this condition, and this condition here is equivalent to psi being a homomorphism of ordered fields from LQ to R, since when is the preimage of R squared equal to Q? Okay, I could say it's if a preimage of R squared intersected with the image of psi of L, if the image of psi is Q, that's of course the same. But now psi is from L to psi of L, if I look at it as a map to psi of L, it's bijective. So I can actually apply psi here, and I could undo this. So I have here that this is if and only if R squared intersected psi of L equals psi of Q. And since R squared intersected psi of L is of course on order of psi of L, this is equivalent to saying that just psi of Q is contained in this, right? Two orders on a field are equal if one is contained in the other, right? And this is if and only if psi of Q is contained in R squared, of course. Okay, so hence we get the unicity and existence of psi from 1.75, right? Because if I have given an order Q on L, and there exists exactly one such psi, that makes this into an homomorphism of ordered fields. Okay. So we will look at a bit more special situation. Suppose Kp is an ordered field, so we take again exactly the same thing. Now instead of an arbitrary real closed field, we take now just the real closure of Kp, and instead of an algebraic extension we now take a finite extension. It's a bit more special, right? Now a finite extension can, of course, when be described with a primitive element. So there is actually an A in L with L is K adjoint A by the primitive element theorem, because we have a finite separable extension, separable, of course, because we are in characteristic zero. But anyway, it doesn't matter. I suppose an A in L is such that L is K adjoint A, so I fix such an A. And let f be the minimal polynomial of a over k. Then there is again a bijection, and again I look at here at the extensions of p to l, like I did before, but this time I can describe them a little bit more concretely. Like here I had these homomorphisms, but now I have the roots of this minimal polynomial in R, right? So the roots, so if I have a root of a minimal polynomial of A over K, A, if I have such a root, X, then this gives me an extension of P to L, namely by saying I take all the G of A, where G of X is non-negative. So maybe you should note that, of course, we have L is K adjoint A, but we have also K adjoint A in the ring theoretic sense then, because A is algebraic over K. So, and this is of course the set of all G of A with G in K adjoint X, one variable X, right? And so the elements of L are all of this form, right? The idea is that the idea is that, of course, let's see the proof. Okay. So this is a bijection. So by 1, 7, 8, it's enough, since we have already this bijection over there, it's enough to see that I have bijection between these things and these extensions here, which maps X to the map G of A maps to G of X. Okay. Yes. Okay, so let's speak later about well-definedness and so on. But suppose we had this bijection. We can compose this bijection with this bijection, right? So I can first map the X to this map, which maps G of A to G of X. And then I can map it here. I can map this map to a pre-image, to its pre-image under R squared. Now, what is the pre-image under R squared? Yeah, that's obviously all G of A such that G of X is in R squared, right? Okay. So all we have really to show is that we have this bijection, right? So let's see what we wrote about that. I just wrote that this is easy to see. Okay, so let's talk a bit about that. So as I said, L can be described in this way here. So if x, let's first speak about why this is a K homomorphism from L to R. First of all, why is it a well-defined map, right? So if I have G of A, how do we do this in the best way? If I have G of A, sorry, if I have G of A equals G prime of A for some G, G prime, K adjoint X, when I have to show for a well-definedness just of this as a map, that G of X equals G prime of X, right? Okay, but if you have this, then the minimal polynomial of A, which is f, divides g minus g prime, and now x is another root of a minimal polynomial, so g of x, so g minus g prime evaluated in X is also zero, and that's clear. So that's a well-defined map. Well, why is it a K homomorphism? That's really easy to see, right? So this map is well-defined. And why is it bijection? So why is it injective? So if I have x and x prime, roots of f. Such that for all g in K adjoint X, g of X equals g of X prime, because these maps are the same, right? Yes, that the maps are the same means that they are pointwise the same, yes, right? So for all g, g of x is g of x prime, right? When we have to show that x equals x prime, right? I guess that's easy. You just take g equal the variable x, right? When you see that x equals x prime. So that was really, really easy. So it's injective. So why is it surjective? So if I have a homomorphism that psi from L to R be a K homomorphism, so when I can see where psi, so set, how do I get back the X? So I set X is psi of variable x, psi of a, sorry. Right, and then now I claim that for all g in kx, psi of g of a equals g of x. Yeah, but that's also clear, right? Psi actually, because it's K homomorphism, is yeah, you see it easily, right? So this is easy to see. It's a bit technical, but everything is easy. Okay. And maybe let's do an example. So let KP be an ordered field such that 2 is not a square in K. And I can denote by square root of 2, 1 over 2 square roots of 2 in the algebraic closure. So for example, K could be the rationals, right? With a unique order on them. And yeah. And when there are exactly two orders on K adjoint square root of 2 that extend P, namely the two induced by the field embeddings from K adjoint square root of 2 into the algebraic closure of KP. In one of which square root of 2 is positive and in one of which it is negative, right? You know from algebra that you can do it, that you have to find these two x two that you find with two field embeddings, right? You can, so x squared minus 2 is the minimal polynomial, and you can map one root to the other or no, or not, right? Okay, so but only one of them is positive, right, in the real closure. So I can make square root of 2 positive or negative, right, like I want. In particular, with fixed square root of 2. In particular, this is true if there are exactly these two orders, yes. Yes, there is no other one because yes, because as an whenever I fix an order here, well, when I can embed it into this real closure here, right? When I fix here an order extending the given order P on K adjoint square root of 2, when I find a homomorphism of ordered fields into this real closure. So I don't know for what is it as actually an example. Yeah, maybe more or less for this theorem, right? So KP was the ordered field. When I take L is K adjoint square root of 2. And when these and for R, I took this real closure, right? And every homomorphism into a real closure from K adjoint square root of 2 gives me an order. Yes, it was an example for this theorem, right? Probably you could also see it in some way as an example for the corollary. Good. In particular, this is true if KP is not Archimedean, right? Right, there are non-Archimedean ordered fields, we know it. And so in 1120D, I guess we have seen one, right? It's actually every order of a field of rational functions in one variable over reals is non-Archimedean. No, 1120D was just the was just the definition of Archimedes. And in this case, we cannot argue with reals instead of real closure, as we did in 135. Yeah, in 135, we had already an example which was similar, where we were thinking about similar things. Namely, here we took just Q adjoint square root of 2. And we also showed that there are exactly two orders. And when we argued why this is so, we said there are two embeddings into the reals and they give different orders. And but when the crucial point was that there is not a third one, and we used that a third one would have to be Archimedean also, and when I would again find an embedding into the reals, right? And now if I don't have Archimedean, then I cannot argue this way. I cannot use the reals for this argument in order to show that there is no third order. But now I can use the real closure. That was a point what I wanted to make, that real closure sometimes helps when the reals are no longer available somehow. Okay. Yeah, and then we are almost at the end. So proposition, let R be a real closed field and K a subfield of R that is algebraically closed in R, I mean relatively algebraically closed. That means every element of R that is algebraic over K lies already in K. That means no element of R is algebraic over K. No, I mean that's not right. No element of R without K, right? Okay, sorry. When K is real closed. Okay, relatively algebraically closed in a real closed field is real closed. You know, similar thing for algebraically closed, right? So if you have here an algebraically closed field, you have here a field, and you have here L is relatively algebraically closed in C, when L is actually also algebraically closed. Okay, let's prove a corresponding statement here. So apply the criterion from 172. 172. It was this one. R is real closed if and only if there is no proper ordered extension field. An ordered field is real closed if there is no proper ordered extension, algebraic extension field. Ordered, right? So every ordered extension field LQ of K with order that is induced from R, such that L over K is algebraic, is contained in R up to K isomorphy. That we had already, right? And therefore equal to K, because we have a relative algebraically closed, because K is relatively algebraically closed, right? Yes, okay. And now example, the field of real algebraic numbers are ALG. So all real numbers that are algebraic over the rationals. Again, a typo, but I didn't make it better, so. Okay, now it's better. This is a field of real algebraic numbers. That's the algebraic closure of, but this is a field you probably know already from algebra, right? It's a relative algebraic closure of rationals in the reals. You can do this with every field extension. This forms again a field. So it's a real algebraic numbers. It's the algebraic closure of Q in R. By 1, 7, 11, our alg is real closed by what we just did, right? Because real numbers are a real closed field. And therefore, they are the real closure of Q, because they are also algebraic over Q. Hence, our alg is uniquely embeddable in every real closed field by 1, 7, 5. Yeah, because every real closed field contains rational numbers as ordered subfield, right? And yeah, we have this, right, so alg, so here I have Q. If I have any real closed field R, because this is algebraic here, you know, by 1, 7, 5, there exists a unique, I can look at it as an ordered field, right? It's real closed. So there exists a unique embedding of ordered fields here, phi. Or psi maybe, right? I always call it psi. Right? I don't have to say that it's the identity on Q, because that's anyway true. That's automatic, right? So it's... And so it's uniquely embeddable in every real closed field. In this sense, our alg, the field of real algebraic numbers, is really the smallest real closed field that's contained in any real closed field. By the way, it's of course a countable field. It has countably many elements. Countably many elements because. I mean, you can easily see that all the set of rational polynomials over polynomials in one variable over rational numbers is countable, and each such polynomial has only countably many roots in R alg, and therefore R alg is countable. Yes. Okay, so of course you could think about how to calculate in R alg. It's an important field, right? For computer algebra, it's maybe the field, right? The real numbers are too much for doing just computer algebra, maybe, right? So, and you could of course think about how to effectively multiply. You could store. How do you represent the elements from R alg? Maybe by representing their minimal polynomial and saying that is the, I don't know, first, second, third, etc. root of this minimal polynomial with respect to the order, to a unique order. And then you can think about how to multiply numbers if they are given in this representation, how to add them, etc. Would be a nice topic, but we don't go into this. Okay, thank you. Thank you a lot for patience. And next time we come to real quantifier elimination. It gets really, really, really interesting. So don't miss the next lecture. Thank you for having been with us here in this lecture. And goodbye.